Hello world. Hackers have taken over a live TV broadcast in Iran, a teenager has been arrested in connection with the massive Optus hack, and an Uber executive has been found guilty of covering up a data breach. That's all coming up in today's roundup of Cybersecurity Tech News. A couple of days ago, Iran's supreme leader was in the middle of giving a speech live on state TV when hackers took over the broadcast. The hijack featured a masked hacker man, followed by Iran's supreme leader, on fire. The hackers called on people to rise up against the government. Why? Well, the context here is quite clear. Pictures of people killed in recent protests were displayed at the bottom, and you can't have missed this in the news. Over the past few weeks, protests have erupted across Iran over women's rights and political freedom. The hack took place at 6 p.m. local time, primetime viewing, but it only lasted about 10 seconds before returning to a flustered presenter. But who's behind this hack, I hear you ask? Well, that's not too difficult to figure out, because the group responsible conveniently overlaid their social media accounts. The group is called Adalat Ali, and this isn't the first time they've hacked Iranian state TV. Back in February, they took over the channel, pushing a similar message. But just like this latest hack, we don't know a thing about how it was carried out, whether it was done remotely or if they had someone on the inside. Either way, the broadcaster clearly hasn't learned their lesson. Often hacktivist groups are criticized for only doing attention-grabbing hacks like defacements, which don't serve to do much other than get them attention. But this group has been behind more impactful operations. Last year, they hacked the CCTV system of an Iranian prison, exposing the abuse of political prisoners. They also released a video of the very moments they took over the security observation room in the prison. One by one, the displays started flickering before displaying the hacker's message. So Iran does have a bit of a history with Mr. Robot-style hacks. Last year, a cyber attack targeted the smart card system that Iranians use to buy fuel, knocking out the system for an entire day, causing chaos and massive queues at fuel stations. It's unknown who was behind that attack, but Iran officially blamed an unnamed foreign country. Also last year, parts of Iran's railway system came under attack, computers in offices were locked up, and departure screens started displaying messages of fake train cancellations. This hack was attributed to a group called Indra, but not much is known about them, or many of the other groups behind these hacks targeting Iran, other than they can't be very fond of the Iranian regime, but they likely have their different reasons. A teenager has been arrested in connection with the Optus hack, and he's facing over a decade in prison. So, a couple weeks ago, Australia's second largest telecoms company, Optus, was hacked. 11.2 million people had their data stolen, and given Australia's population is only about 25 million, almost half of Australians were affected by this. Now, this wasn't your average data breach where some names and email addresses were leaked. Oh no, it was far, far worse. Sure, the breach included the standard stuff like names, email addresses, and phone numbers, but there were also dates of birth, physical home addresses, driving license numbers, and passport numbers. This leak really is the stuff of nightmares, because the data could be used to commit severe identity theft, like taking out credit cards and loans in someone else's name. The hacker claims to have downloaded the data via an unauthenticated API that allowed anyone on the internet to access Optus user data, so it was a really easy entry point for the miscreants, who demanded $1 million from Optus. In exchange, they wouldn't sell their copy of the data to other hackers and would instead delete it. And to prove they meant business, the hackers leaked the data of a couple hundred people. But Optus didn't pay, so a few days later, the miscreants leaked the information of 10,000 more people and pledged to release more if they didn't get their money. In response, the Australian police, with the help of the FBI, launched Operation Hurricane in a bid to hunt down the hackers. After this news, the miscreants behind the hack began to have second thoughts and ended up making a surprise U-turn, reneging on their $1 million demand and publishing an apology. They claimed to have personally deleted the data from their drive and that they only had one copy. They offered their deepest apology to Optus and added, "Optus, if you're reading, we would have reported the exploit if you had a method of contact. No security email, no bug bounties, no way to message." Obviously, these crocodile tears aren't fooling anyone. In fact, the miscreants had already made clear they were abandoning ship because this story received too many eyes, not because of some change of heart. But by this point, the damage had already been done. The hackers had already released the personal information of 10,200 Australians in their sample data. They apologized to them, but it's way too late for that. A bunch of scams have already been launched targeting the people unlucky enough to be included in the leaks, one of which was in the form of a text message. The message impersonated the hackers and basically said, "If you don't send us $2,000 within the next 2 days, we're going to sell your data to other hackers." Obviously, this is a bluff because the data is already public. And strangely, this scammer didn't demand payment in some cryptocurrency, but instead via a regular bank transfer, a strange request from a cybercriminal in 2022. Police quickly found out who was behind these text messages, not because of some small OPSEC failure on behalf of the scammer, but because these redacted bank details were for an account registered in his real name. It turns out that this scam was being run by a 19-year-old, and it doesn't look like he put more than 5 minutes into planning his scam, because after the police raided his home, they found a mobile phone which sent the messages. It sounds like there's a good chance this guy was actually just sending the texts manually. And unfortunately for him, he's now facing two charges. The first could land him in prison for 10 years, and the other for 7 years. But this guy had nothing to do with the initial Optus hack. The miscreants behind that are still at large. A former Uber executive has just been found guilty of covering up a hack in which data on over 50 million users was stolen by criminals. The hack went down back in 2016. Hackers accessed an Uber employee's GitHub account, where they found some AWS login credentials, which they then used to access a backup containing data belonging to 50 million Uber customers and 7 million drivers, containing things like names, email addresses, and phone numbers. And as you would expect, the hackers demanded a bunch of money from Uber in return for their silence and deletion of the data, $100,000 to be precise. At the time, Uber's chief security officer, one Joe Sullivan, had only just finished testifying to the US Federal Trade Commission about a completely different cyber attack on Uber that happened in 2014. I can't imagine he wanted to go through that process again, and to save Uber some reputational damage, he agreed to the hackers' demands, in a move that would spectacularly backfire. So the $100,000 payment was disguised as a bug bounty, as in Uber directed the Black Hats to sign up to their bug bounty program, after which Uber sent them the cash. Now, abusing a bug bounty program to buy the silence of Black Hats is pretty bad practice, to put it lightly. But what makes this whole cover-up so illegal is that Californian law requires companies to disclose data breaches to their customers. To make matters worse, the chief security officer, Joe Sullivan, who signed off on all of this, was previously a prosecutor for the US Department of Justice. So if there's anyone who should know better, it's this guy. Funnily enough, after the $100,000 was paid, Uber discovered the real identity of one of the hackers. Did Uber use the opportunity to report the guy and come clean about the hack? Of course not. They instead had him sign an NDA, promising to never spill the secret. But secrets, the cover-up did not stay for very long. The plot was eventually rumbled, which resulted in Sullivan losing his job and being charged with obstruction of justice. And, well, he's just been found guilty of the cover-up and is now facing potentially 8 years in prison, though he hasn't yet been sentenced. So this is the first time a senior executive has faced criminal charges over a data breach, so I guess it does set a bit of a precedent for future incidents. However, as always, there is some controversy in that it's thought that Uber's CEO knew about the cover-up, but for whatever reason, he wasn't even charged. You could argue, and it is being argued, that way more people are to blame than just the chief security officer. In fact, Uber has a bit of a history with questionable practices and data breaches. Their first data breach was in 2014. Then later in the same year, it emerged that an Uber executive was using a tool called GodView to track the locations of journalists and celebrities, which they were then fined $20,000 for. Then there's the cover-up of the 2016 hack, which, by the way, cost Uber almost $150 million in fines. And finally, there's the Uber embarrassing hack I covered in a recent video, where an 18-year-old managed to gain almost complete access to Uber systems, just to troll them. This video was made possible by Octopart, a website I've been relying on over the last few years in my electronics business. Octopart.com is essentially your component sourcing Swiss Army knife, making it simple to keep tabs on component stock levels in real time throughout a range of distributors, which is pretty important given the current component supply situation. You can also easily grab datasheets and CAD models for components when you need them. The best part is, it's free to use, and Octopart is integrated right into Altium 365. If you want to give Altium a go, you can find your free trial link in the description. As always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Have a good one.